Hello everyone, today let's see the working of a 4x4 matrix keypad and a 16x2 LCD. Then finally let's interface them to an STM32 microcontroller unit to visualize the outputs. First, let's understand how a 4x4 matrix keypad works. A matrix keypad is a keypad which has set of switches interconnected. It is an input device which can accept the user inputs. These kinds of keypads are found in many embedded devices such as your calculator keypads, the keypads in your microwave ovens, and even in some of the gas stations we can see the keypads being used to enter the data. So these finds applications in various places, and one of the advantage that a 4x4 matrix keypad provides is it can get interfaced to a microcontroller or processor with just 8 data lines. As shown in the figure, here I am using a 4x4 matrix keypad which has 4 rows and 4 columns. I am considering the row pins as output pins and the column pins as the input pins. The column pins are being pulled down with the help of pull down registers, and then they are used as input pins. Now consider I am pressing key 6. Once the key 6 is being pressed, there is a connect between the rowth column and the columnth column, that is the R2 row and the C3 column. Once they both gets connected, the circuits get completed, and then the output current from the output pin of row R2 will flow to the C3 pin. And this is how the microcontroller unit or the processor unit is detecting the key that is being pressed. And similarly, it applies for all the other keys. Whichever key that you are going to press will make a connect between the respective row and respective column, and that is how the circuit gets completed. So this is how the working of a 4x4 matrix keypad is. Now let's look into the working of a 16x2 LCD. As we all know, LCD stands for liquid crystal display. It is a kind of electronic display which is used in many such embedded applications such as mobile phones, calculators, computer displays, as well as television displays and so on. The display that we are using here is a 16 characters in a single line display, and here we have 2 such lines, so we can display up to 32 characters. And each character is nothing but a picture element as shown in the figure, and each picture element is nothing but 8 rows and 5 column pixel. So consider here we have 32 such pixels to display our characters. Further, let's analyze the pinout of the LCD displays. There are 3 such special function pins called as register select pin, read write pin and enable pin. The register select pin is used to toggle between the data register and the command register. Whenever we set the register select pin to high, it is chosen as data register, it chooses as data register, and whenever we set register select pin to low, it chooses command register. Read write pin is used to either read or write the data into the LCD, and then enable pin is a special function pin which latches the data that is present on D0 to D7 pin to the registers. And then there are 2 pins called as anode LED plus and anode cathode LED minus. So these 2 lines control the backlight of the LCD. There is one more special function pin to control the contrast of the LCD, that is the contrast pin. This pin is nothing but the output that we have received from the 10K potentiometer. So this potentiometer is again connected to VCC and ground. This internally controls the contrast of the LCD. So that's about the pinout. Now let's move further for the working of the LCD. As I said, we can select both data registers or command registers based on the register select configuration. Now, first, whenever we receive the data from the microcontroller unit, it goes to the control unit, and the control unit sends the data based on the register select pin to the DDRAM. The DDRAM finds an appropriate ASCII match in CD-ROM or CD-RAM. I'll tell you what is CD-ROM. CD-ROM is nothing but a ROM which has set of predefined characters in it, but a CD-RAM is a RAM where we can write our own predefined characters. For example, if we need a diamond shape pattern which is not available in CD-ROM, we can write our own pixel images into CD-RAM and then we can display it in the LCD. So that is a kind of special function that use a CGRAM to display special characters or user-defined characters. Once the data RAM finds the appropriate ASCII match, it energizes the LCD, and that is how we are able to see the character on the display. So that's about the working of a liquid crystal display. Now, as I told, there is a command register, and from the data sheet we are able to see a set of few commands which controls the operation of the LCD. I have presented two such commands here, that is 0x01 and 0x38. 0x01 is used to clear the screen, and 0x38 is used to force the cursor to the second line. These are nothing but example commands which are obtained from the data sheets, but there are many such commands which are given in the data sheet to control the operation of the LCD. So that's about LCD. So let's look into the schematics of our project. In the schematics as shown in the figure, we have connected the lines of the LCD into the port A of STM32 microcontroller unit, and then the VCC and ground is being connected to the potentiometer. From the potentiometer output, it is being again redirected to the contrast pin of LCD. So varying the potentiometer will vary the contrast of the LCD. Similarly, the 4x4 matrix keypad is being interfaced to the port B pins of the microcontroller unit. The rows are set as output pins and the columns are set as input pins. The rows and columns both are connected to the port B pins of the microcontroller unit. Further moving on, let's see how the flowchart of our program is designed. Initially, during the start of the program, we have written a function called as keysDetect. This keysDetect function performs a scanning of the columns. So initially, we are going to set row high at a time. Whenever we set row high at a time, we are going to poll for the columns one by one. If the column red is high, then the key is set to be detected. If the column is not read as high, then again we are going to perform next iteration by setting the next row as high and the remaining rows as low. So only one row is set as high and the rest of the remaining rows is set as low. So you have to keep in mind that one row high and the remaining rows are set as low, and then the columns are scanned in every iteration. So by this method we can identify which column has gone high and we can detect the key that is being pressed. Similarly, once the key is pressed, we are going to display the key number on the LCD display, and then once the key is displayed on the LCD, again we go back to the same function, that is keysDetect. So this is how the flowchart of our program is designed. Now let's quickly make the connections and see the outputs. Let's look into the coding part. So here I have shown the pin configuration. In the pin configurations, as I told before, we are using D0 to D7 pins as output pins for the LCD data, and then the three special function pins, that is enable, read write and register select, is also set as output pins. And then the rows pins of X keypad or matrix keypad is set as output pins, and then the column pins are set as input pins. So this is how the pin configuration I have done for our controller. And then let's look into the clock configuration. So the clock configuration, in the clock configuration I have set it as 8 MHz, so it should be fine to run our keysDetect function. It can go up to 48 MHz max, but I think 8 MHz should be fine. So now after this I have generated the code. So once I have generated the code is available in the Keel Microvision. But before that, let me introduce one functions called as HAL functions. So we'll be using a driver code which has been provided with the STM32. So this is a HAL function. HAL function is nothing but a generic function which can be used which can be used throughout the STM32 microcontroller unit, and which is a good feature which has been provided by STM32. So I'm using two functions, that is HAL-GPIO read pin to read the column pins, and I am using one more function called as HAL-GPIO write pin to write the either high logic high or logic low to the pins. So these are the two APIs which I'll be using to write the code. So now moving on to the code, I have written the code in Keil Microvision IDE. So the first line is inclusion for the respective controller header files, followed by main.h, and then these are the two functions to set the system clock and perform the GPIO initialization. Moving on to the next function prototypes, that is these are nothing but LCD init to perform the LCD initialization. And as I told before, there are two registers, one is command and data register. So this line is this API is used to send the data for the command register, and this API is used to send the data for the data register. Finally, we have one function called as LCD string, and see, in the program we will be sending a complete string, so that string has to be splitted by character, and it has to be sent to the respective function. So that is the reason we have using one more LCD string API. And finally, we have one function called as keysDetect. So this keysDetect function is the function which is going to perform the scanning of the column pins by setting the individual row pins. So now, and I have one more variable called as data. This is an array. This is an array of type integer. And then I am going to use this data array for some specific purpose. I'll let you know in the end. Now let's move on to the main function. So in the main function, by default, we have to perform the HAL initialization, that is hardware abstraction layer functions initialization. Moving on to the next, we are configuring the system clock and then initializing the GPIO. So as I told before, I used one global variable, that is array. So this data array is used to set the individual D0 to D7 pins in the array. And then finally, this will make our setting of high pins much easier. So that I'll show you in the next. Now let's see the initialization of LCD. So I am performing the initialization of LCD using LCD init, and then HAL delay of 100 microseconds. So once the initialization done, just give some one second delay, followed by I am giving a UI. This is the UI, and then followed by we are having a while loop. So in the while loop, I am continuously polling for the switch changes, that is by using the function called as keysDetect, and I am giving some minor delay. So let's look into the keysDetect function. So this function is used for scanning of the columns. As I told in the logic, firstly we are going to set row 1 high and the remaining rows as low, and then perform the scanning for the column function. So like that, once the row 1 pin is set as high, I am going to scan all the column pins, that is C1 to C4. So if the column pin is read as high, then I am going to display as key 1, else I am going to check for the other column. So similar way, the next row pin, that is R2 pin, is been set high and other pins are set low, and I am performing a scan for next column pins. So like that, I have done the scanning up to R3 pin and even R4 pin. So similarly, for R4 pin I have done. So this is how the keysDetect function works. Moving on to the next function, that is LCD init. See, in the LCD init, we have set of commands. As I told before, we have set of commands. So this command is used to set for 8-bit mode. There are two modes, one is 4-bit mode and 8-bit mode. So I am setting it in the 8-bit mode. So now, once 8-bit mode is set, I am turning on the display, and cursor is set as off. So again, one more command for auto increment of the cursor, and I am clearing the display and setting the cursor to ohm position. So next API is LCD command. In this API, as I told before, whenever you want to talk to the command register, you have to set the register select pin to low. So that is what I am doing here. And read write pin, by normally it will be low. So then as I have used one array called as data pins array, here I will be using a for loop to set the individual pins. So that makes me easier. So this is how the LCD command is done. And then finally, I have told one enable pin is needed. One enable pin is used to latch the data that is present on data pins to the registers. So whenever you have written something, so use the enable pin to latch the data to the register. So I have used the enable sequence here. Moving on, similarly for the LCD data also I have done, but here I have set the register select pin as high and followed by setting the data using for loop, and then again I am giving one enable pulse. So this is how the LCD data and LCD command APIs has been designed. Moving on to the string function, that is LCD string. So we are passing a complete string to this function, and then we are passing one by one character to the LCD data function. So one complete string will be passed here and will be collected here, and then finally I am passing one by one character up to null character. It will be evaluating in the while loop, and then we are passing one by one character to the LCD data function. So that is how we are sending the data. And then finally the system clock configuration is there, followed by GPIO init. So one error handler and one assert paint. So this is how the code is designed. Now let's flash the code and visualize the outputs. For flashing, I am using STM32 ST-Link utility software. In the STM32 ST-Link utility software, we can see the memory locations too. So let me connect to the target. So once the target is detected, now let's perform a full chip erase. So I'll be erasing the chip. So the chip is erased now. Let's flash and check the output. So this is the X code that has been generated. So before that, I have built the code, and this is the X file that has been generated. So then let's flash this. So I have started the programming. Yes. So the programming is done. Now let's visualize the outputs.